Heard the term big data and PySpark thrown around and felt a little lost? If you have wondering where you should even start, you are in exactly the right place. In this video, I'm going to take you from zero to building your very first PySpark project. We will break down the world of data pipelines into simple, easy to understand steps. By the time we are done, you will have built a real ETL pipeline with PySpark processing actual data from CSV file. You don't need any experience to follow along. So let's get started. We are generating more data than ever. Every click, purchase or streams add to it. For small dataset, Excel or Pandas are fine. But when your data grows into billion of rows, your server can't handle it. That's when you need a tool that can process data across many computers at once. That tool is Apache Spark, and PySpark is how you use it with Python. So, what exactly is Apache Spark? Instead of thinking about one computer doing all the work, picture a team of thousands of computers working in parallel. You give each computer a small part of a huge task and one clear set of instructions. Together, they can finish a job in a fraction of time. That's the core idea behind Apache Spark. It's a distributed computing system that takes a huge data processing job, breaks it into smaller tasks, and share them across a cluster of computers that work as a team. And PySpark, that's the tool that let Python programmer give instructions to that team of computers. It's the Python API for Spark. It lets us use the simple, readable Python syntax we love to control the massive power of a computing cluster. It's the perfect bridge between the most popular language for data engineering and the most powerful engine for the big data. The project we have building today is a data pipeline, specifically an ETL pipeline. ETL stands for Extract, Transform, and Load, and it's the backbone of pretty much all data work. First, we extract the data from wherever it lives. That could be a database, an API, or in our case, a few CSV files. Next, we transform it. This is where the magic happens. Real world data is always messy. It has errors, missing values, and weird formatting. In the transformation step, we clean it up, reshape it, and add new information and get it ready for analysis. Finally, we load our clean transformed data into a new home. This might be a data warehouse, a different set of files in a better format, or a dashboard. So, to wrap it all up, we are going to use PySpark, our Python toolkit for distributed computing, to build an ETL pipeline. We will take raw data from a CSV, clean it, and process it. And then save the final result. Ready for action? Before we can build our pipeline, we need to set up our environment. Luckily, it's very simple. As long as you have Python and its package installer pip, you are ready. Just open your terminal and run this one command, pip install PySpark. That's it. With PySpark installed, every script you write will start by creating a Spark session. This is your gateway to all the Spark's power, connecting your Python code to a Spark cluster, even if that cluster is just your laptop for now. Here is the code to create the session. Let's quickly break this down. We import Spark session and then we use a standard builder pattern to create our Spark object. We give our job a name, simple ETL pipeline, which is useful for tracking it in real production environment. The .get or create command is clever. It's either create a new session or gives it the existing one. With this Spark object ready, we can start now our ETL process. First up is extract. We need to read our data into our PySpark application. For this tutorial, we are using a CSV file called customersorder.csv. Let's pretend this file has raw order data from an online store with columns like customer ID, first name, last name, order date, and order total. In PySpark, the main thing we work with is called data frame. If you have ever used Pandas library, this will feel very familiar. But there is a huge difference. A Pandas data frame has to fit completely into your computer's memory or server's memory. A PySpark data frame is distributed. It's like a virtual table, but the actual data can be spread across hundreds of different machines. This is what lets it scale up to handle enormous data set. To read our CSV file into a data frame, we will use our Spark object that we had created in an earlier snippet. The code is pretty straightforward. Let's walk through this. Spark.read gives us access to data frame reader, which is built to read all sorts of data format. We use .option header is true. This is super important. It tells PySpark that the first row of our CSV file contains the column names, not actual data. And you don't want that. Next is .option infer schema is true. This is a handy option that tells Spark to scan the data and try to guess the data types for each column. For example, it will look at a column full of numbers and call it an integer, or see dates and call it as timestamp. This is a great for quick analysis, but it can be risky in a real project. If Spark guesses wrong, you can get a weird bug later on. A much safer and highly recommended option is to define the schema yourself. An explicit schema is like a contract for your data. It forces the data to be loaded in the exact format you expect. Here is how you define a schema for our customer data. We import all the data types we need. Struct type defines the whole data frame structure, and struct field defines one column. For each column, we give it a name, a data type like integer type or string type, and a true or false value to say whether that column is allowed to have empty or nulls values. Now we can read our data using this bulletproof schema. Once the data is loaded, how do you check it? The two important commands are .printSchema and .so. df.printSchema will print out the schema of your data frame, so you can quickly check all the column name and their data types. df.so will show you the first 20 rows of your data frame in a nice little table. It's the perfect way to get a quick look at your data and make sure everything is loaded correctly. Raw data is almost never perfect. Our job is to clean it, reshape it, and enrich it until it's actually valuable. PySpark data frames have a whole suite of functions for these kind of transformations. Let's start with something easy. Our source data might have more columns than we actually need. We can use .select transformation to pick just the columns we want to keep. This creates a new data frame df_selected that only has those four columns. Next, let's filter out data. Maybe we only want to look at orders that were for more than $1,000. We can do that with the filter transformation. This code tells Spark to look at the order total column and only keep the rows where the value is greater than 100. Now for something a little more advanced, it's pretty common to want to combine columns. For example, We have first name and last name as separate columns. Let's make a new column, full name column. We will use the withColumn transformation, which can add a new column or just replace an existing one. Here we import the concat underscore ws function, which is short form of concat with separator. We tell it to create a new column called full name by joining the first name and last name columns with a space in between. What about data quality problems? Let's say our order total column sometimes has missing or null values. If you try to do math on nulls, you will get errors. We should probably fix that. The dot fill NA function can replace those nulls with a default value we choose. This tells PySpark to look for any nulls just in the order total column and replace them with a zero. Now let's chain all of this transformation together. One of the best thing about PySpark is how you can line up this transformation one after the another in a really clean and readable way. We have just built a little pipeline of transformation, but here is an important concept in Spark you have to know. Lazy evaluation. When you write all the code, Spark doesn't actually do anything. It doesn't read the file, it doesn't filter the data, and it doesn't create that new column. Nothing happens. Instead, PySpark build a logical plan, kind of like a blueprint of all that step you asked for. It's only when you finally ask for a result, what's called an action, like calling .so or writing data to a file, that Spark's optimizer look at your entire blueprints, figure out the most efficient way to run it, and then execute the job across the cluster. This lazy approach is a core feature that makes Spark so fast. It avoids doing any unnecessary work until the absolute last second. If you are finding this guide helpful and the pieces are starting to click, hit that like button below. This will encourage me to keep making more in-depth tutorials just like this one. This video is just the first episode in the series. In the next one, we will cover episode 2, where we will master PySpark Data Frames Essentials Transformation to build your core skill. Then in episode 3, we will get into advanced concept with PySpark Streaming, processing real-time data like a pro. Okay, we have extracted and transformed our data. Let's get back to it and finish our pipeline by loading the result. We are at the final stage of our data pipeline load. Our data has been extracted, cleaned up, and processed. Now it's time to save it somewhere so it can be used for reports, machine learning models, or whatever else in next. We can write our transformed data frame back to a CSV file very easily. The syntax is basically a mirror image of how we read the data using a data frame writer, which we get from the dot write. Let's check out the options here. Dot option header is true. Tells PySpark to write the column names as the first line of our output file. The dot mode override option is very important. It tells the Spark what to do if that output folder already exists. Overwrite will delete the old folder and its content before saving the new data. You can also use append to add the new data to what's there. Ignore to nothing if the folder exists, or error if exists to fail the job, which is actually the default. Now here is a detail that trip up a lot of beginners. When you run this command, PySpark won't create a single file called output folder. It creates a folder with that name. Inside that folder, you will find the actual data split into one or more parts. files with names like part 0000.csv. This is a direct result of how Spark works. Each computer in the cluster processes its own piece of the data and writes out its own part. For huge datasets, writing in parallel like this is a way faster than trying to force everything into a single file. While CSV is easy to read for big data, it's not the best format. A much more efficient and powerful format is Parquet. Parquet files also include the schema and have much better compression, making them the industry standard. Writing to Parquet in PySpark is even easier than writing to CSV. For almost any serious data pipeline, you should be using Parquet instead of CSV for your final output. So, let's recap what you have accomplished. You have demystified big data by building a genuine ETL pipeline with PySpark. You now understand the core component like the Spark session and distributed data frame. And you have seen the power of lazy evaluation and professional data format like Parquet. The journey doesn't stop here. The best way to master these skills is to practice. I have linked the code and sample data in the description. Download it. Experiment and challenge yourself. Try exploring other transformations like group by or join. Anyway, I'm going to discuss this in my next episode. If you found this tutorial valuable and want to learn more, make sense to subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss the next video in the series. If you have any questions or ideas for future tutorial, drop a comment below. Thanks for watching and happy coding.